Hi, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. So I'm director of product for RavenPack. My talk is not going to be so technical. It's going to be more of use cases and how big data can be applied to businesses. As our head of operations, I can ask me a lot, where's the money? So I'm going to go through some of the actual ways in which our clients are using our data to this day. So when I was studying software engineering around 20 years ago, one of my professors told me that software engineers do software and they don't do databases. As I began my career, I soon realized that, well, data is forever while software comes and goes. So it's really important to have a good database to work on. And that's kind of where big data is starting to fit into industry. A few months ago, my wife and I had our first baby, and apart from being bowled over with how beautiful she is, I was actually quite intrigued at how she takes in all of the data that she has around her. She's, you know, constantly taking it in and absorbing it and reacting to her senses. And in a similar sense, businesses today are still in their infancy when it comes to data and how they can use it and how they can benefit from it. So my talk is going to deal with that a little bit today. As of 2 years ago, actually, but it's still a similar metric, 29% of business decisions used some form of data, okay? That means that all of the rest are using, you know, gut feeling or advice from people. And even still, these decisions are using some level of information. You know, they might go off and get a report generated by some consulting firm, or maybe they have invested in some big data in their own organization. So what are the major obstacles to this? Well, one of the things are lack of ability. People don't have the tools to actually get into the data that they have in their own organization. Lack of completeness. Maybe you have some kind of database that you have available, but it's not giving you the full picture. You need to pull in other kinds of data sources in order to be able to make a decision. And timeliness. Sometimes it just takes too long to crunch data or to have somebody else build a report for you that gives you some proper insight into how you can make a decision. So these are the kind of things that hold people back in the industry. And we've been working in the big data field for quite some time, and we've found ways in which we can deal with these problems. So as I said, my talk today is not going to be technical. It's going to be more high level. I'm going to take you through what RavenPack does as a company to tackle big data and how we approach it. I'm also going to take you through some of what our clients do with our data. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about solving those problems that I mentioned earlier on. And that's, how do you bring together all of the data that is available in an organization, and how do you make it available to people in a sensible way? So first I'll just give a little bit of a background as to who RavenPack are. We're a technology company, and we've been in Marbella for around 13 years. I've been there for all of that time. And we service hedge funds, people in the financial space. Probably some of the biggest banks and hedge funds in the world would be our clients. The typical type of client that uses our big data are what's called a quant. For those of you that don't know what a quant is, a quant is a mathematician. And they basically build statistical models using all kinds of input that you can get in order to trade on the stock market and make money. So if you ever have tried trading yourself and you lose lots of money because there's a big sharp turn in the market, it's usually these guys that are taking the money from you. So we're based down in Marbella, although most of our clients are based in places where there's large financial markets like the US or in the UK. But it is nice to have our R&D center down there. Most of our clients tend to want to come out and visit us quite a lot just to make sure that we're there and take in a few holes of golf. So first of all, I'll talk a little bit about what we do. We convert unstructured text data into structured information that can be used in modeling or in searches or in queries. So unstructured text has a lot of value in it, and many of our clients have actually tried to tackle this themselves. For instance, in the old days, you would have had a guy sitting down reading a newspaper at the start of every day to figure out, well, what's going on with the stocks I'm trading in? Well, that doesn't happen these days. They have terminals that are able to give them news and feeds, but even that's not enough for these guys. If you're going to trade systematically and make decisions in real time with no human interaction, you need to have some way of quantifying tech. So that's what we do. Why do we do it? Well, we believe that there's a lot of value in that. If you look at text, there's a lot of noise in there. There's a lot of people posting things like cat pictures, or you have coupon sites that send out tweets constantly. However, if you are able to actually build the tools that can analyze all of this content and extract the meaningful information, then there's actually a lot of value to be had from that. There's a lot of people that would pay a lot of money to get that. So what is unstructured data? Well, unstructured data is text, as I said. It's news publications, it's social media posts, blogs, tweets, it's research articles, it's email, it's attachments to email. It's anything that comes in an unstructured form that a human would have to read. And what we do is we take in all of that content and we convert it into a kind of a canonical or generic format that allows us to put it through our classification system and send it out to our clients. So this is kind of like an overview of what our system looks like. It's very, very high level. But basically we have systems that are able to go out and get this unstructured content. This is all written in Java. We have a Java team that's dedicated to building pluggable systems. It's very, very quick for them to integrate a new source. Once we get that, we push it into our real-time analysis platform. This is written in Common Lisp. And we're able to classify lots and lots of text in real-time and historically whenever we need to. We push this out in real-time to our clients. Remember I said that timeliness is one of the most important things when people are trying to make decisions. If you wait too long, well, business moves too fast. So you've got to be able to act. And we basically push that straight out to our clients, and they either put that into their own database or they incorporate it into an event processing system that can get into or out of the stock market. We also provide a downloadable historical archive. As I mentioned, the people that use this type of data are statisticians, and they need to be able to build models and test them, and they need to have lots and lots of data that they can back test it on. So if they want to say, hey, I think that whenever Apple decides to acquire some company, that company's stock price is going to go up. Well, they need to backtest that throughout history. So we provide over 16 years of data for them to test again. So I'm going to take you a little bit through a little bit what we actually extract from this unstructured content and how we structure it. Okay. The first thing we tend to do is, apart from tokenization and doing the low-level natural language processing, we extract the entities that are mentioned in the text. So this is named entity detection. We currently track a database of about 400,000 different entities. You can have, for instance, companies. That's one of the major things that our clients want because they actually trade these companies. We also track people, places, currencies, commodities, products, tons of other types of entities that you could see in text, but more importantly, that are important to people. So that when you actually see them, you want to know about them and to be able to index those inside a text document. In order to be able to do this, we have to maintain our own database of all of the different ways in which these entities can be referred to. For instance, IBM has acquired lots of companies over time, and we've got to know all of the different aliases that could be used to refer to IBM. Also, we've got to solve problems like, well, how do you tell the difference between Apple, the fruit, and Apple, the company? Not so easy. So we use a lot of confidence scoring in order to be able to say that the company that was detected is the correct one. We also track all of this stuff in a point in time sensitive way. So when we're backfilling history and companies have gone through, let's say, mergers or acquisitions, well, we're able to tell that. We track all of that information. The next thing that we do is event detection. So for every mention of an entity within a document, we try to find out, well, what happened? Okay, so it could be Apple saying that they're going to acquire Tesla. Well, we want to be able to pull out that information and say, this is an acquisition event. But we also want to be able to say something like, well, Apple was the acquirer in this event, and Tesla was the acquiree. So those two have different roles. The acquirer, well, if you're trading in the stock market, the stock price tends to go down. Whereas if you're the acquiree, your stock price tends to go up. We have a taxonomy of around 6,000 different events that we track. So it's quite complete, and it maps into many, many different types of data sets. So not just news and social media, but you could apply this to many different databases as well. The next thing we do is relevant scoring. So often what these quants want are to be able to scan through all of the history for a particular company and find all of the relevant information. Where was that company mentioned in a way that I want to be interested in? So we take all of the events and the entity detections and we put that together into an algorithm that allows us to say, okay, well, on a percentage-wise, this is how relevant this company is. If a company plays an important role in a story, for instance, well, we'll say that. Or if an entity, let's say a product, is mentioned at the very end, well, maybe that's not so relevant, so we'll give it a low score. Novelty scoring is also very, very important because if you're trading in the stock market, you want to trade on that first event. You don't want to trade on all the chatter that follows afterwards. It's very important to be able to distinguish between that, because often you have the cycle of where, let's say a tweet comes out and it mentions something that could cause the stock to change. A journalist picks up on that. And then all of a sudden, all of the other news agencies start to pick up on that as well, and you have this media storm. Well, we're able to detect that first event and send that through in real time. We'll also send through the chatter, but we have that annotated so that our clients can tell that maybe that's not so interesting. Sentiment scoring is also important. We take two approaches to this. First of all, we look at the whole document that we receive, and we give a general sentiment score as to, well, is this positive or is it negative? Okay, so for instance, did the journalist write this document in a negative way or a positive way? You can often have things like, for instance, a press release could be communicating something very negative, like Toyota doing a product recall because maybe the brake doesn't work in their car. But you want to be able to tell that and to make sure that what they're transmitting is detected in a way that you can say, okay, well, that's actually negative. So we also do event-based sentiment scoring. If a bankruptcy comes out, well, that's negative. A product recall, that's also negative. So there's two different views of sentiment. We also track temporal scores. So it's quite different when you receive some document to say, okay, well, this is happening right now, to when the text says, Microsoft announced their earnings last week. Well, that event took place last week, so we'll give you out that type of information. It's also important to be able to say, okay, well, Microsoft announced their Q4 earnings as opposed to their annual earnings. The people that trade in stock markets deal with that information in different ways, and they use that to trade. Kind of the opposite of novelty scoring is media buzz. Okay, so I talked about the chatter and the media storm that you can have. Well, it's interesting to know that too. Maybe you want to be able to know, well, what are the top companies that are being mentioned today in the news? So you can use media buzz to actually say, not just the novel events, but how much chatter is surrounding this company. Another very important thing is relationships. Okay, so it's interesting to know that different entities are mentioned together. You could identify competitors in all of the news corpus that you have, or supply chains. It's often very difficult to find information about which companies are supplying other companies because, well, they don't tend to publish that because that's their client base. But they may mention business contracts, let's say. So we track the event business contract and we can say, okay, this guy's the supplier, this guy's the buyer, and you can make all of these connections. Another important thing is to be able to say when somebody is making an opinion. It's not the same thing to say that Apple is going to acquire Tesla when a journalist comes out and says, well, what would happen if Apple were to acquire Tesla? You want to make sure you distinguish between those two events. They're very, very different. And finally, we also wrap up our sentiment in a kind of an aggregate score. So their clients are able to say, all right, forget about all this granular stuff that you have here. What's happening with the companies that I'm interested in? So we give you a score per day per entity that's able to tell you, okay, it's good or bad. What is the media saying about this? What is the kind of the attention score? Okay, so that's a kind of an overview as to what structured data we can pull from this unstructured content. There's a lot more than that, but these are kind of like the key areas that you can get. So processing all of this content is quite hard. RavenPack uses the Amazon Cloud in order to be able to process all of their content. We have a database, as I said, of 16 plus years of news and social media, and it takes a lot of processing power in order to be able to handle that. As I said, our systems are written in Lisp. They talk to databases in a distributed format. So when we first wrote our system, it was quite easy to transition into this kind of cloud-based setup. Parallelism is important. There's two areas in which we exploit parallelism. For instance, when we're analyzing content in real time, we're able to run different classifiers simultaneously. Some depend on others, so we need to run those in serial, so we make sure that that happens. Like, for instance, you wait until the entities are detected until you actually try to find out what the entities did. But there's other types of classifiers that we run in parallel. Also, when we're backfilling history, our clients need to know all of what happened in the past. Well, we do that in parallel as well. It takes about a week to analyze our full corpus. Real-time streaming is important. Our clients need to be sure that the events that came out in real-time are received by them in the same order in which they were published. So we've built a system that ensures order is maintained, and it pushes through the information that they receive in a way in which they can just incorporate that into their systems. And finally, latency is very, very important for these guys. It's not as important as some of the high-frequency guys. You've got some people that are interested in microseconds. Our system is based more around the millisecond space, so it takes 200 milliseconds on average for a story to go into our system and then come out on the other end. If you put that in context, it takes around 300 milliseconds for somebody to blink, so it's still quite fast. And when you think that news tends to have a delayed effect in the stock market. So a news story comes out, it takes time for most people to start to react to it. And often it has a long-term effect. It could have an effect that lasts for days or weeks or even months. So we focus a lot on latency, on reducing that as much as possible because our clients demand that. This is part of this whole idea of timeliness. People need to know things as soon as possible. Okay, so now I'm going to skip over and talk a little bit about who uses this and what the use cases are. As I mentioned, the people that tend to focus most on this type of product are called quants, quantitative analysts. And about 75%, maybe even a little more, of our user base are quants. These guys take this data. They put it into a model that they have. It's usually called a black box model. Whenever they're selling this to people that invest in their funds, they call it a black box model. Nobody's allowed to know what actually happens in there. We don't know what they're doing either. But they take our information and they trade on that in real time. So they're buying and selling during the day, or maybe they're doing at the start, getting out at the end. They're taking a lot of decisions based on our data. But it's all systematic, no human interaction. The next one are discretionary traders. So you still have a lot of people that like to sit in front of a terminal and press a buy or a sell button. Or maybe at the end of the day, they want to go cash because, well, they want to take whatever their earnings are. So that's what these guys are. They can take our data and they can get a high-level overview as to what's the sentiment of all the stocks that I'm trading right now, or what are the major events that are happening, or did one of the companies that I'm trading right now suddenly come into the media spotlight for some reason. This integrates directly into tools. So you would feed that data in and it drives these kind of platforms. Like platforms like E-Trade and that would be the types of platforms that would use that data. Portfolio selection is quite interesting too. A typical kind of model that the quants would use is to look at our data, pick the top most positive 100 companies and buy those. That's called going long. Pick the bottom, most negative 100 companies and sell those. That's called going short. And then at the end of the day, get out again. So they rebalance their portfolio every day. But this is interesting for lots and lots of different people. They want to be able to pick a portfolio. You want to know which stocks you should be invested in. The next one are event-based traders. These are people that tend to go intraday. They want to know when an event occurred so that they can get into the stock market, and they want to know when another event occurred so that they can get back out again. But there are other kind of use cases. Like a typical use case is this buy on the rumor and sell on the fact. So for instance, if Apple comes out and if a journalist comes out and says, what would happen if Apple were to acquire Tesla, then you could buy on that and say, well, that's a rumor that's going on. That's an acquisition rumor. And then maybe in 2 months' time, Apple actually does buy Tesla. Well, you can make a lot of money on that. You get out again. More use cases. If you've ever set up a pension plan or an investment plan, then you've probably been asked, okay, well, what kind of a plan would you like? Would you like a conservative one? What age are you? Are you an old person? Come on. You gotta get something a little bit more aggressive. That's what they tried to sell you. Well, if you've got a risky portfolio, then you expect a high return. So you can use news in order to measure the risk that's associated with the portfolios you're trading in. So imagine you've got a lot of junk stocks down there and they're getting terribly negative news. Well, you'd know that this is a risky portfolio. Or you might be able to monitor in real time and pull out those kind of values to say, well, we should change our portfolio. Another way in which you might look at that is when macroeconomic events take place. So imagine if for some reason the UK decides to leave the European Union. Well, Brexit would be something that would drive risk for an investor. Another thing is market surveillance. So especially since the crisis, there's been a lot of emphasis on insider trading and the bad kind of things that these traders do. You go to jail for this, and there's a set of mechanisms in place to prevent insider trading. So you've got state-organized organizations that monitor whenever something illegal is going on. But it's ultimately up to the individual traders to make sure that whoever is trading on their behalf are not taking decisions based on something that didn't get into the public space. So a way in which you might do this is you look at a sharp drop in the stock market and you say, okay, well, just prior to that sharp drop, was there anything in the public sphere? So you could look at news analytics and systematically say, ah, there was something in the public sphere. I don't need to worry about that. If there wasn't something, then you need to set up an investigation and find out who was trading on insider information. Another good one is competitor analysis. So if you know who your competitors are and what products they have, well, you can use our data in order to pull out all that information, patent filings, legal issues. Maybe that legal issue involves you and you just didn't know about it. Or acquisitions that they're taking on. So this is a very good tool for being able to do that. Finally, I mentioned earlier on about the relationships you can derive from news and social media. Well, supply chain analysis is important. If you're Apple, for instance, and you're getting all of your products from Foxconn, you need to know who is serving Foxconn so that you can be sure that all of the orders that you're going to ask them to build for you are going to be made on time. So you can monitor that quite well by figuring out who these are through their relationships and then monitoring all of the news that's going on about them. Is there some kind of flooding going on in one of the countries, for instance, that these companies are based in? So that's how people use this type of big data. And as our head of operations asks me, that's where the money is. So I'm going to shift gears a little bit again. I said I'd talk a little bit about how you can deal with those questions that people have on the ability to access data and getting that complete picture. Gartner came out with their magic quadrant this year. Gartner comes out every year with a kind of a study or an analysis of an industry or sector. And in this case, they were talking about the business intelligence and analytics platforms. And some of the sound bites from that article was that there's going to be more emphasis on things like access to self-service tools. that people are going to expect end-to-end analytics platforms. They're not going to have to outsource this to one company, outsource that to another. They want to be able to get everything from one source. Next generation data discovery is going to be important. That's being able to find those relationships between entities, for instance, and be able to make inferences about what could be happening to make decisions. And that natural language processing is going to be fundamental to this, because the type of data that you can get that is currently big data, it represents only 20% of the whole set of data that you have available in the world. 80% of data is actually unstructured. So let's take a look at what type of data an organization actually has available to it. On the left-hand side, we've got the type of information that you get in the public sphere. So this is like, you know, news, press releases about the company, or maybe it's write-ups by journalists, or maybe they did something bad. Their own corporate website, that's something front-facing that's available to the public. Competitor activity, so competitors might either be talking about them, or they're talking about the competitor's space. So that's also important for an organization. Either they have their own social media presence, or perhaps they have a lot of products that people are just tweeting about. That's public information, and this is the type of data that you can actually get from RavenPack today. On the right-hand side here, we've got proprietary data. This is data that is inside the organization. So you've got like your sales data, all of the types of information about who your clients are, how much they're paying, shipping and satellite tracking. Are you on time? Where are you sending things to more often? Internet traffic data. Who comes to your site? Where do they come from? How often do they arrive to the site? CRM systems. This is actually really, really important. I was in a text analytics conference last year, and I talked to a lady there that was from a reinsurance company over in the US. And the reason why she was there was that they had lost a client that was spending $50 million per year. And the reason why they lost that client was that a low-level support person had been dealing with the client directly, and the client was not happy at all, and they decided to just leave. Either that low-level support person didn't feel that they had the authority to raise the issues that they had up to the senior levels, or they just missed it. But either way, they missed this data, and they needed to be able to find a solution for that. How could they keep track of that kind of information and not lose $50 million clients? Other areas in which you have organizations' data available is through third parties. So you have, for instance, credit and valuation. So you have credit agencies like Dun's and Bradstreet that tell you if a client is worthy of loans or not and what their current loan structure looks like. Or you might have crowdsourced data. You have a company like Estimize, for instance. Estimize takes information from people in the public sphere. What do you think about this company? Do you think they're doing well? Do you think they're doing badly? And they come up with estimates as to what their future performance is going to be. And finally, we've got anonymized data. This is probably the more controversial type of stuff. So you've got sites like Amazon, or you've got payment processing systems like PayPal. What kind of transactions are going on there? And can you actually get information about what kind of products are being sold for a company, or who is selling products for them? So this is all very, very important information in order to be able to make enterprise-level decisions. So how do you actually derive value from that type of data? Well, first you sign up for RavenPack. As I said, that's the public side. Okay, so you need access to what's going on in the public sphere. It's fundamental. You need to know what the perception of your company is. So you can get that quite easily already. Organizational data. Well, companies tend not to want to give out their own data. They don't want to give you their sales figures. They don't want to give you any of this internal information. But they know that they have to. They don't want to do the heavy lifting themselves. So if you can map all of these data sets together, find a way to extract common information and map it, then derive things like relationships between it, you can drive processes like brand tracking or competitor insight or supply chain tracking or customer churn, reducing how many customers are actually leaving your site. Maybe you have terrible news in social media circles. And as I went through in quite a lot of detail, trading. So RavenPack is actually building a self-service platform. We're putting together a system that allows us to bring in our own data, bring in many, many other different data sources, map those together, and provide them back to users in a way in which they can drive their own decision-making. We're expecting this to be ready sometime in the fall. That's October for people in Europe. So the different areas of this platform that we're building, this is just an early mock-up that we have. But the kind of the key areas are being able to query your data. So all of this data that pertains to you, you want to be able to get access to it and join to provide the relationships between it. Be able to visualize it. This allows you to be able to see that data and get access to it in a way that you can answer your own decisions, your own questions. Connect to the data, so be able to pull it in. And finally, to be able to send your own data to the platform. So going through that in a little bit more detail, I mentioned about entities and events. So entities have identity. Each entity that we track has its own unique identifier, and we can make sure that when we find that, that is really that entity. So whether that's products or currencies or companies or people, whatever, they all have their own identity. So if you can match entities across different types of data sets, then you provide that relationship that allows you to start to delve into the data in more detail. Also, you can apply the event taxonomy. So if our news analytics data says that a company's earnings are going down, maybe you want to relate that with the transactions and payments processing data that I mentioned, the anonymized data, in order to be able to figure out, okay, well, what are their sales really like? If I look at all of the products owned by a company, well, can I predict their earnings? Satellite tracking data and internet traffic also fit quite well into this data model, that you can track all of the different types of products being shipped around, and on an internet traffic basis, you can track where companies are receiving their traffic from, and maybe by who even. So visualization is something that we're also taking an approach to. We're not going to build a BI tool, where you can just draw graphs on whatever data set is available. We believe that each type of data has its own way of visualizing it. It's important to know that and to accept it, because there's different ways in which you can be efficient about pulling back that type of information. This is some examples that we have here for news, for instance. So if you want to be, if you're a trader and you want to look at news, you may want to see, you know, news feeding through for each of the companies in your portfolio. Whenever anything important happens, it pops to the top and flashes and lets you see that. You might want to delve down into one of these companies and start to see, okay, well, how does the sentiment compare to the actual stock market price? Is it rising when the stock market is rising? Is it dropping when the stock market is dropping? And what kind of events are driving that? You might want to get a tree map view of that company's events. Okay, well, let's look at Alphabet. In this instance, Alphabet are receiving a lot of products and services news, but I've also got some insider trading. Insider trading can also be normal stuff where it's just the CEO buying or selling stocks. Legal issues, well, that could be bad for them. But in general, you can see that this is a positive view of Alphabet. Alphabet is Google. Also, you may have some signals that you want to trade on. So for instance, rank my companies. Give me those top 10 and the bottom 10. I want to be able to buy these guys and sell those guys. Okay? This is the type of visualization that you have for news analytics. But if you're incorporating things like, you know, CRM data, customer tracking, or sales data, or satellite information, or payment transactions, well, they've got their own ways in which you would visualize those. And that's the kind of visualization that we're building into our platform. Being able to connect to the data is very important. We want to be able to serve this information out to our clients and also allow developers to be able to integrate this into apps or tools. So for instance, you can imagine a mobile app that's able to connect to our REST API and maybe subscribe to things in real time. So we've got a historical fetch API that allows you to just pull back data for any period in time. A real-time push API that allows you to basically just subscribe to something and receive information from us based on whatever you're looking for. Integration for high-level apps like MATLAB or R. We'll also have a Python library. Whatever we need to integrate to, we'll do there. We'll integrate with BI platforms as well. As I said, we're not going to implement that, but there are lots of tools out there that are very good for looking at data and giving you a high-level picture of it in order to answer questions. That's where companies like Click and Tableau will come in. And we'll also provide access to our Redshift instance so that people can do ad hoc queries. Maybe they're evaluating this data, or maybe they're trying to actually generate this for themselves. And we want to take that cost away for them, because it can be quite expensive to maintain that yourself. Finally, the idea of uploading data. And this is actually one of the major things that we've heard from our clients. We've had tons of clients come to us and say, listen, we need to process all of the information that we have for compliance reasons, in order to make sure that nobody is doing insider trading. We need to track all of the chats that people have on Skype, on Slack, on any other IM. We need to monitor people's email, because at a corporate level, we need to make sure that we're not doing insider trading. So the types of data that you can have at the business level is internal research or external research, things that people are receiving. Sometimes you subscribe to the same research service multiple times in a big organization, just because nobody is talking and they're spending all of this money. So they want to make sure those kind of ideas are shared. Email. So I know this sounds like, you know, a big privacy problem, but it's also something that's very real for businesses. They need to be able to track things that are going on in their organization. Transcripts, that can be phone transcripts. You have earnings calls, for instance, where the CEO comes out and he gives some forward-looking views as to what they think they're going to do in the stock market and in general in business. Well, that actually gets converted into text by people. So you can have a transcript service that is either human-generated. There's also some automated services that can give you that. So you can make sure that all of this type of information is being written down, available to the organization. Sales data, marketing data, CRM, information on competitors, all of this type of information is interesting to these guys. So we provide the ability to upload this information. We scan it, for instance, with things like email. We can figure out, okay, who's being mentioned, what is being mentioned about it. We map that together, the entities, the events that we track, and then we deliver it straight back to the clients. So if the information is not sensitive, like research or maybe their marketing information, which is external, or their competitor information, we can pipe that back through a public API. But as you might guess, there's quite a big issue with sensitive information. So we do provide either a private cloud or an on-site installation where things just stay within that organization. The idea with this, though, is to unify data. So in order for decisions to be made, in order for that gap to be made for organizations to drive decisions within their enterprise, they need to unify all of the different data sets that they have. So that's the talk. And to summarize, I guess, what I would say is that in order for big data to actually be used for these types of business decisions, in order to raise that 29% that are using data right now, we need to be able to access all of this. Data needs to be democratized for an entire organization so that anybody can access it, anybody can drive their decisions. As I said, 80% of data is unstructured. And there is value in that data. Even though there's noise, there's a lot of value in there as well. Data is only used for 29% of decisions in businesses. And in order for data to be democratized, you need data unification. Thank you.
If anyone has any questions. Oh, Alvaro, do you have a... The microphone is on its way. Gentleman back there in the grey jacket.
Hi, Hi. Was a great session. I have two questions for you. One, so you showed initially a lot of sentiment analysis, natural language processing, etc. So do you do all this only with English, or do you also cover other international languages?
Right now, we're only doing it with English. So if we need coverage in another geographical region, we do rely on translation services. So when I say translation services, I mean journalists that actually translate the information for us. It is in our plans to do multiple languages.
All right. And the second question was, you said that you have a data repository that runs like 15, 16 years back. So I suppose the data is growing at an alarmingly fast rate. How do you manage the back-end side of it, your data storage? Mm-hmm. How do you manage that?
Yeah, well, up until a few years ago, we were actually managing that in a centralized way. We basically use a single database for storing all of that information. And anytime we needed to backfill history, it would take us quite a long time in order to do that. As you kind of suggested, it was growing at an enormously large rate. But we've turned to the cloud. We're basically using the Amazon cloud to store all of the information that we have. We take advantage of the parallel processing and being able to scale up as quickly as possible in order to analyze all of that history. So as I mentioned, it takes around a week right now, and that's only because it's more cost effective to do a week. We could actually do all of our processing in about a day if we wanted to. We only tend to analyze everything on a periodic basis. Mostly we have everything classified already. It's available for people to query whenever they need to. Thanks. Any other questions?
Kevin, fantastic presentation.
Thank you.
You focused on unstructured data. Do you consider mixing it with structured data? Would you not bring in share prices or, you know, regular structured feeds as well, so you can compare what unstructured is saying against its actual share price or a Bloomberg report or whatever?
Definitely. And part of what I was talking about was unifying all of those different aspects of data in order to merge that 80% unstructured content with the 20% structured content that we currently have. Right now, for instance, ways in which you might join those data sets are, as you mentioned, prices. You could see in the visualizations, we can put those together. Also, you can have market response techniques that actually say, hey, if I see a certain news event coming out and there's a reaction in the stock price, can I measure that over time and then repeat it going forward? There's other structured data sets that you have. For instance, analyst estimates can come out in either a text format and sometimes in a structured format. And we take advantage of all of that. We classify it ourselves when an analyst says, we think this stock is going to go up, and we incorporate that as structured and feed that back into our system. Thanks.
We have a lady in the middle there.
First of all, thanks for the excellent presentation.
Thank you.
My question, just out of curiosity, would be, since you have to operate, or your service has to operate on this low latency requirement, do you have to plan for where to locate your servers, since you also deal with traders that are, mm-hmm. I guess, based in the US? So you have to think about this. And to follow up on this, how does it work with your competition? Do you have do you see competition in terms of latency or more in terms of data quality?
Yeah, so to address the first question, our current real-time system is based in a server farm that we maintain ourselves. So the kind of the real-time feed has to be processed really, really quickly and sent to our customers as quickly as possible. So we're actually based in New York, right beside one of our main providers of content, and right beside the exchanges. They happen to be in the same data center. So that's one of the ways in which you reduce latency there. And for competitors, the space that we're in is kind of niche. There's not so many of these quant funds. There's many more in the discretionary area that I talked about. I think the place where we compete is not in latency. As I mentioned, it takes a long time for news to actually be incorporated into the stock market. We're probably the lowest latency solution, but our clients kind of assume that that's going to be like that. Probably the place that we compete more is in quality. So did we detect all of the events? When you compare two products side by side, which one can you derive more value from?
Thanks very much.
Any other questions?
No? I had two questions as well. The first one would be, Do you think Apple is going to acquire Tesla?
I actually read that in the news the other day. There was I was working on one of the events in our taxonomy, and I saw a story coming out. One of the examples that I came out about opinions was a journalist saying what would happen if Apple were to buy Tesla, and that's the story that I read, and I went, wow, that's an interesting thing to ask.
You never know. Like three times, so I started to think.
Yeah, I thought it was a good example.
But apart from that, what types of systems do you have in place to validate the quality of your data on both a real-time and historical basis?
Yeah, quality is very, very important. So we have a number of different systems set up. We have as many automated systems as we can in place. So for instance, looking at the structure of the data to make sure that only certain types of data can be sent out and that, you know, we're not going to make mistakes. That's all set up. When you talk about this type of solution, you normally measure it, and search engines do the same thing. You normally measure it through recall and precision. Recall is how many documents you're able to pull back from a particular corpus. And precision is whether you got them right or wrong, okay? So we put a lot of work into measuring precision as well. That's mostly human-based. We do also use a lot of our own systems in order to make sure that we're not missing anything. So we can compare events that we had received and make sure that, you know, they were correct. We also do use, as was asked, other data sources in order to say, like, there was a massive move in the stock market. What caused that? We go in and we actually look at the events that were just prior to that and make sure that we classified it correctly, we didn't miss them, we got them right, etc. Quality is very, very important. Any more questions?
Thank you very much, Kevin.
Thank you very much.